Is it true? Did I hear that you walked into your camp one night to find Bigfoot roasting marshmallows over your fire? Did he really steal all your hot dogs and hamburgers? Dear goodness, I want to hear about all that. No, really, I want to hear it. Send me an email to contact@buckeyebigfoot.com and tell me exactly what happened. Then I'll get it narrated, put it up here, because we all want to hear about it. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Well, it's been a challenging week. I appreciate all of you hanging in there with me. But I take a lot of heart in seeing all the bulbs that are coming up outside and all the other beautiful signs of spring popping up out there. I sure hope that spring is breaking and showing her beauty wherever you are. And for those of you listening in the Southern Hemisphere, I hope your autumn is mild and beautiful. Now, we've got two good encounters tonight. We have a return first from Travis, the 16-year-old you might remember from the other week. He's a First Nations young man from British Columbia, and he sent us stories, and he promised us another about a scary camping trip. Well, he's back to tell that story. Then after that, we have a retired Navy man telling his story. So, snackage up, climb in the saddle, folks. We're heading on down into Sasquatch Valley right now. Hello, Nance. It's Travis again. I just want to say that I will not be responding to any comments in this video, and I'll be staying anonymous. I like my privacy, and I don't want to be called names or anything. Now, you can choose whether or not to believe my story. I'm not here to convince anyone. I just want to get it off my chest and out into the world. I will say, though, I am very observant, and whenever I play games or anything, I always have it to a volume where I can still hear my surroundings. We have the window wide open in my room, so I would have clearly heard the bushes moving and other noises. Oh, yeah, I forgot to mention my cat. She is still alive and I think okay. She doesn't come inside anymore, but she survived a snowstorm and many weeks out there without having to come back to the house for food. So I think she's been hunting on her own and taking care of herself. But I do know she's alive and well, so the Squatch didn't eat or kill her. But to the camping story. I'm not going to say specifically where we were camping or any of our real names. Last summer, it was my friend Nick's birthday, and he wanted to celebrate it by camping with his friends and family for 2 days. At the time, he lived on a reservation on the upper part of Vancouver Island. One of my other three friends picked me up from my house, and Nick was already up there, and he was going to meet us there. We drove up there from my house nonstop, and it took us 4 hours from my house. We passed many towns, and we had to take a few bridges. But when we finally got to the campgrounds, it took quite a while to find him, and he had to come and look for us on foot. We were in a truck, so we found his family before he found us. It was around 3 to 4 p.m. when we got there. My friends and I start unpacking everything from the truck. Our snacks, food, drinks, tents and sleeping bags, and our clothes from the back of the truck. The campground we were on was on a beach, and we'd be able to hear the waves from our tents, and we had the tree line and bushes to the side of our tent. Nick's family had already set up a few tents and had a campfire going, but we wanted our own camping area, so we found a flat area and started setting up our tents. My three friends, Josh, Andy, Victor, and I, we slept in one tent that was able to fit 6 people. It was a bit crowded, but it was doable, while my friend Nick and his girlfriend slept in their own tent that had their backs up against the bushes and the tree line. Later, his brother set up a tent across from ours, so we had a little circle with a campfire in the middle. We dragged over some logs from the beach to sit on around the campfire. It was quite relaxing. We mostly were just goofing around for most of the day, and we had a water gun fight and then talked around the campfire when night came. My friend was the only one that brought a marshmallow holder thingy that he used on the campfire, so we sharpened the ends of sticks and made them thin enough to hold marshmallows over the fire for us. We just sat around the campfire and talked and played music until we got tired. We didn't get to see the stars, though, because it was cloudy. There was no wind or rain or anything. It was a peaceful night. When I went to sleep, my friend started playing his music on his phone, and then we all fell asleep. You could also hear the waves from the shore, too, so it was really easy to fall asleep. It was really relaxing, and I needed this camping trip. Ever since COVID hit, our school went to online classes, which stressed me out because I couldn't do any of it. I didn't have any motivation to do it, and it was hard to focus on any of the work. So this camping trip was just what I needed. Nothing happened that first night, and I had a pretty good sleep. The second day, we mostly just sat around the campfire and talked a lot, and we went and we walked along the beach for a bit. We all took a lot of pictures, but it wasn't really eventful, just relaxing. Another family came around. It was Nick's mom's and dad's friends and their family, and they came in an RV, so they didn't have to set anything up. When dinner time came, Nick's mom went to go get some oven-made pizzas from a restaurant that was about an hour away, and Nick made some hamburgers and hot dogs while we waited. After dinner, we talked with the other family and sat around the campfire for a while. We talked until the other family got tired and went to bed. So we went to our little circle and talked around the campfire. We started to hear bats squeak, and they freaked me out a bit, so I went into the tent. But they weren't vampire bats or dangerous to us. They were just fruit bats. Well, that's what Nick said anyway. I don't know if that's what started getting me paranoid or anything, but I started getting this uneasy feeling. I just laid in the tent and tried to go to sleep. My friends were still talking, and they finally came in once it started to sprinkle a bit, but it wasn't enough to take the fire. They came in the tent to tell scary stories. Also, Nick came into our tent, and his family and his girlfriend went back to their place to sleep. So it was just the five of us in the tent and his brother across from us in his own tent. The others were telling scary stories. I put my headphones on and listened to my friend's music since I had lost my phone earlier on in the day. But that uneasy feeling amplified, and I became a lot more paranoid for some reason. I started to get a lot more paranoid that I started to curl up in my blanket, and I tried to calm myself down with my friend's music, but it was a new kind of paranoid for me. For some reason, every song sounded scary to me, and I would always think that I heard something outside the tent, but it turned out to just be the music. Whatever I listened to, it sounded scary, like whatever songs I was listening to sounded super creepy. It's hard to explain. I switched spots, so I was sleeping on my friend's air mattress, so I had my back to the tent side that was facing towards the bushes. So my back was all against the bushes. For some reason, I had a strange feeling like something was going to grab me. But nothing ever did. I was still feeling paranoid, and nothing was helping me. But I tried to go to sleep. But whenever I closed my eyes, I would see these monsters with big sharp teeth and red glowing eyes just watching me. So when I closed my eyes, I didn't see blackness. I saw those creepy-looking monsters. Now, nothing was ever there, but whenever I closed my eyes, I saw them. One of them looked like a werewolf or dog man, and all the monsters were all hairy and on two legs. It was scary. I couldn't listen to the music because it sounded scary. And I couldn't close my eyes because I would always see those monsters. I was very paranoid, very uneasy, and it was very hard to fall asleep. But I did eventually fall asleep, and for some reason, without any reason, I was waking up every few hours. One of those times, I saw that the fire outside had grew back up, but went back down after a while, and then I went back to sleep. Another time, I smelled this pea-like smell. It was really strong, but I pushed it off as nothing because my friend had peed on the campfire before coming into the tent, so I just went back to sleep. But another time, I woke up, and I heard something heavy walking out there on the sand. It sounded like it was walking on 2 feet. But I was so tired. I was too tired to care, and I went back to sleep. Once morning came, I was back to normal, and I was completely fine, and I acted like nothing ever happened to me. So we just carried on with the day and started packing up sometime after lunchtime. I didn't tell anyone how I was feeling until weeks after it happened. I was talking to Josh about how I was feeling, and he said that he had had that uneasy feeling too, but it wasn't as bad as mine. He just felt like something or someone was going to jump up and scare us in a joking way. But nothing ever happened. I told about the pea smell and told him I thought it was his pea smell that came from the campfire. But he told me his pea never smelled that bad before. I now think that we were being watched by a Bigfoot. And I think it was walking around our tent, and that was the pea smell. It was really weird, though, because I've never, ever felt that paranoid or that type of scared before. It's never happened to me before. And hearing every song scary and creepy, I mean, even the happiest song, Mr. Blue Sky, sounded scary. Having that feeling of being taken or something, it was a new feeling that I've never, ever felt before. I've never been so scared that I curled up on the bed. There weren't any other nearby campers except the other family in the RV. I didn't check the time when I heard the footsteps, but I'm assuming it was around 3 to 4 in the morning. Everyone in our tent had fallen asleep around 12, and everyone got into the tent around 11. I asked everyone that went on the trip and was in our tent. I asked if they went to go use the washroom or anything. But nobody did that night. It wasn't the family in the RV, because they wouldn't do anything like that. It wasn't Nick's brother, because I heard him snoring during the night at times. And there was nobody nearby to come by our tent. Well, there was another family, but they were quite a distance from our tent, so I don't see why they'd walk that far just to come and walk around our tent. I didn't get to see any footprints in the sand because it started raining when everyone fell asleep. And closing my eyes and seeing those glowing red eyes and the monsters just watching me? Well, that's never happened to me before the camping trip. These feelings were new and never happened after the camping trip. So I think there was definitely something watching us that night. I don't know what, but I think it was a Sasquatch. I was scared that night, and I don't know what set me off. I never want to feel those feelings again. So, I don't want to go camping because I really don't want to feel those feelings again. I'm scared that I might also see something like a Squatch or something. But I also do want to go back out camping because it was really calming and relaxing. I think next time I'll make sure that we bring a weapon to defend ourselves and have the snacks in a different tent. Typing all those feelings I had are scary, just saying them out loud. When I saw those creepy creatures when I closed my eyes, I just saw them on some hill, but I somehow knew they were watching me, that they were physically looking at me. I never ever want to feel those scared, paranoid feelings ever again. I didn't see a Sasquatch, but I did some research, and it's the only thing that would explain everything that happened that night. There's this other channel, Bob Gimlin, and he talks about Bigfoot. They have really good Bigfoot videos and see it from a little more of the scientific view. It's a good channel. I don't have much else to say. I probably won't be sending any other emails after this one, unless something new happens around the house, and if anything happens on the camping trip. So goodbye, until next time. Signed, Travis. Nance, I love your channel. Grab your snacks, because here's my encounter. I retired from the Navy after 20 years serving on submarines. My deployments were arduous and long, so I cherished every minute that I could spend on solid ground in Mother Nature. I mountain biked my entire life, so this was my favorite pastime. I have over 3,000 miles of riding in the forests of New England. All during the daytime, with many animal encounters, deer, bobcats, beavers, fox, coyotes, and wolves, to name a few. The only thing more abundant in the woods of New England than the stone walls and rivers are the animals. It is when I started staying overnight on the long rides that things changed for me. My home is in a suburban area. There are many state forests and wildlife preserves within 5 miles. I decided to start riding out of my house with the intent of doing 20 to 30 miles with an overnight stay in the woods. Bears and cougars, they're extremely rare here, so I didn't take any precautions that you would take going into large forests. My overnight stays were zero impact on the environment. No fire, pack out what I packed in, used a hammock, and very little disturbance to the ground. The first few overnights were incredible. A couple hours after dark, the woods came alive. Everything was moving. It was unsettling at first, but you get used to it. I was intrigued with the communications the animals had. They would talk back and forth. I came to learn that a human in their house was unsettling for them. I would often hear animals approaching. You would hear a couple distant and one closer, just moving in on me to check things out. If they got too close, I would start singing. This answered their curiosity as to what I was, and things would quiet down. Coyotes and wolves never came close. I could hear the large packs going by, but they never bothered me. On my final hammock overnighter, I brought my DSLR camera. I had been practicing low-light shots and time-lapse photography. It was a full moon, and I was hoping to set up the camera and a remote trigger for a long exposure so I could actually capture what was out there moving. It was after dark when I arrived at what looked to be a good spot. I had very bright LED lights on my bike and helmet, so riding in the dark was no different than the day. I set up the hammock, hung a tarp above it, raised so I would see 360, then set up the camera equipment. The clouds had moved in. No light, no stars, no picture. It was pitch black. I stowed the camera gear, climbed into my incredibly comfortable Wiggy's 20-degree hammock sleeping bag, and dozed off. I was awakened a little after 1 a.m. by approaching footsteps and some chattering communication going back and forth. I could make out 3 animals with my ears. I was a sonar technician in the Navy, so my ears are my weapon. One animal north-northwest, a second south-southwest, and one approaching between them due west. This was not the typical leaf rustle that you get from small critters. It was heavy, slow, moving in cautiously. It would take 2 steps, stop for 5 to 10 minutes just observing. Then it would do it again. It was stepping very lightly, but its weight caused slow, distinct crunching of the twigs and leaves on the forest floor. A fear swept over me, intense. There was little that scared me. It was a kind of what the heck moment. I had my 1700 lumen light hanging on my tarp's ridgeline just above my head. I quietly retrieved it and felt for the on switch. But I was curious, and I did not turn it on yet. The animal still sounded about 100 yards out. Over the next half hour, I let the animal close in. My heart was pounding, but I felt this was a once-in-a-lifetime chance to see something rare, as I had never encountered this kind of approach. The animal decided to step up the game, and it hit the ground really hard with something. I don't think it was a stomp. It sounded like a 100-pound log hitting the ground just right, just to get a shocking effect. It was effective. I was shocked, but I was still curious. I stayed quiet and still. This animal's routine became take two steps, then wham into the ground. The wham was big, and the animal was getting close, maybe 20 yards now. I was pretty sure if I let it get close enough to land a hit on me, I was a goner. I did not want to turn on the light until it was close enough to see, but not close enough to hit me. The light would certainly blind it, and it would turn the situation to my advantage. Now, the thing was really close, and I turned on the light. I saw two red eye shines up high. They dropped down to the ground. I saw no fur, no antlers, just black. I could see no outline, just the eyes. The eyes started to move back and forth in a snake-like fashion. I figure it was trying to get out of that beam. Now it was blind. I shut the light off. This animal took off like nothing I have ever experienced. I could hear every bound. It was powerful, and it was within a couple seconds that this thing had to be a half a mile away. After that, it was quiet, very quiet. I went back to sleep. In the morning, I looked for footsteps or any sign of what it was or how it had hidden from my light. The only cover was a small bush, but you could clearly see right through it. Very puzzling. It must have either been invisible or had fur that absorbed light. There was just nowhere to hide, and I had hit it with 1700 lumens at 10 yards. 5 years have gone by. I am in the middle of a state forest as I write this. I'm in a small trailer, lithium and solar powered, off the grid, infrared camera on the door. Still enjoy the outdoors, but my sleeping arrangements have changed. There's a very thin line between courage and stupidity. Keep up the good work, Nance. Hoping to move through the Buckeye State on the way to Lake Michigan this summer, stopping at state forests on my way. Well, I do hope you get a chance to come through the Buckeye State, and I do hope you get a chance to stop at some of our more, shall I say, notorious or infamous state parks like Salt Fork. That's big for Bigfoot sightings. They have a whole place there called Bigfoot Ridge. Otherwise, do stay safe out there. You know, and I keep saying it because it really is true. You do not have to see a Bigfoot to have the bejesus scared out of you. And these two stories tonight prove it. I also say, and I say again, I think we often hear them far more than we see them. And I also love that each of these encounters mentions snackage. Yes, dear Travis, please never sleep with your snacks inside your tent. Me? I learned that the hard way while very young. All right, folks, here. I think I'm going to tell you a story real quick. Here's a little something of Nance's life long before Buckeye Bigfoot. Let me set the scene for you. 2, 14-year-old girl sleeping out in the backyard of a suburban home just north of Cincinnati. Zero chance of bears, Bigfoot, wolves, or anything else to bother us, except the creepy teenage boys down the way. But all the surrounding neighbors had been told that we would be out there, which was really kind of nice because they were all taking turns keeping an eye on us all night. And at the risk of sounding hokey, it was a dark night with little or no moon. We felt perfectly safe out there. We were having a great time, and we had taken some snacks out there with us. I mean, of course we did. This is me. Nance, we are talking about here. A 14-year-old Nance who was always snacking. My love of snackage was no less when I was a teenager. Anyway, one of the snacks was a bag of Doritos, which I had been eating. At some point, we fell asleep with the food still inside the tent. At some other point, I woke up in the darkness to the sound of a crinkling of a bag. I thought about it. What am I hearing? Then I heard distinctive munching, crunching sounds. And that's when I knew I had one of those snack-stealing night ninja monsters in my tent. As I'm working all this out, I hear the bag rustling and moving more. I'm pretty sure it's trying to pull my bag of Doritos out of the tent. And I thought, how is that? And then I remember we hadn't pulled the tent zipper down all the way before falling asleep because we kept running in and out all night to go to the house for stuff. So that's the whole backstory. I didn't know what was in that tent. It could have been a squirrel, a cat, a dog, a baby Bigfoot, an adult Bigfoot for all I could see in the darkness. I didn't know, but I knew one thing. I wasn't giving up my snackage without a fight, and there was a fight for sure. Next thing you know, there's all kinds of screaming, yelling, and I'm whacking everything in that tent wildly with my pillow. I'm blindly grabbing for the bag of Doritos, and the whole time, there's this angry chattering going on. And at one point, while I'm grabbing for those Doritos, I grab fur. Now, of course, by this time, my friend is awake and screaming. Her parents hear it. Every neighbor connecting to their yard hears it. And it probably sounded to everyone like the Manson family murders were going on all over again right there in the backyard. Now, this battle raged for what felt like an eternity, but not really, of course. Suddenly, back porch lights are flipping on, dogs are barking, people are yelling, and the whole neighborhood comes out. And what they come out to find is 14-year-old Nance in her pajamas fighting a raccoon over a bag of Doritos. Now, I'm not proud of this, but I have to tell you, I'm also not proud that I was not the popular kid on that block in that neighborhood for the rest of the summer. I will say that. Although years later, every time I talk to someone from that neighborhood, we still laugh about it. Now, that really happened, folks, and I'm not sure what it says that I'm going on 51 years old, and I can honestly say that I have fought a raccoon over a bag of Doritos, but I can honestly say it. So there you have it. There's a little story about how I learned to never keep food where you sleep when you're outdoors, even if that outdoors is just camping in a suburban backyard. All right, everyone. Well, I hope you enjoyed that little funny. Now, in case you missed it, my interview from the Shadows podcast is now up on YouTube on their channel. I'll put a link up right there in the corner. See it? Right there. And I'll put a link in the video description below. So you can go on over, have a listen, and take a look at all their different topics. They might have a lot that interests you. I know a lot there interests me. And if you see a lot you like, hit that subscribe button. Shane and Jason are really great guys. I promise you won't regret it. All right, well, everyone, I think I've ran on enough tonight. I'll be back on schedule for Tuesday night. We have another story lined up from Michaela, the young girl who has been telling her mom's stories. I think you will all enjoy that. I also have another story, and I haven't let that person know it's going up on Tuesday night, so I don't want to mention it yet. All right, everyone, well, until we do meet up again, you can rest assured that I'll be putting the sass back into Sasquatch. And while I'm doing that, and you're out there poking around for the big guy, I need you to always remember that absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone. Sasquatch says, you need to hit that subscribe button right now. Sasquatch says, thank you.